Hey everybody, it's Jimmy and Ryan back with the Cashflow Tactics team. Today we're going to do a quick video on how you can use these policies to enhance your vacation. You want to say hello, Ryan?
Yeah, what's up, guys? This topic that we're going to talk about today literally, and I don't want to come over the top on this, but it literally changed my life and probably saved my marriage. So that's really how important this is. I mean, we're going to show you a strategy that I've been using in my life for the last 9 years now. That has transformed the way my wife and I plan, the way my wife and I live, and the connection that we have with our children. So that's what we're going to share with you today.
And the way I kind of came up with this idea is, you know, I'm in real estate, so wherever I go, I want to maybe find appreciation from an asset instead of always paying on a liability. So we always do Airbnb, which I love. And it's basically I become a renter for a week at a time. And I really don't want to get a vacation house or a second home because I'm going to have a personal guarantee on that note. And then I'm committed to always vacationing at that same house. And I'm going to pay a ton of interest on that asset to a bank. So if I could find a way to get the money I'm spending on vacation to appreciate, and I don't have to have a personal guarantee on a loan, and I'm not committed to the same vacation spot, I'll do it. And so I called my buddy Ryan and said, if I put the money into a life insurance bank first, am I accomplishing those goals?
Yeah.
I'm just going to run through those numbers.
Okay. And this is awesome. So I'm going to kind of share a little bit on that too, because we're going to come at this from two different angles. Jimmy, you're going to talk about, you know, how to make an asset appreciate. And I'm going to talk about how to keep your marriage, you know, safe. So here's, I'm going to give you a little bit of background then on how this changed my life. So my wife and I, we met back in college. We were seniors in college. We decided to get married. And like any young, somewhat naive people, we had these really big dreams about what we were going to do after college. And it was really funny. I remember getting out of college and I got my first paycheck. And honestly, I was pretty disappointed with it. But all of these ideas of traveling the world and doing all of these things for me went out the window. Because two things really happened. Number one, I was in a job that I could not stand, and my goal was to save as much money and get out one day. I was going to be one of those 401k millionaires that Jimmy and Bob talk about a lot. And then number two, every time I spent money, I felt really guilty about it. And it all came to a head for us. You know, we were living in Dallas, Texas at the time. We had our little son. He was about a year old at the time. And we decided to go from Dallas down to San Antonio and go on a vacation. Now, we got online on one of those online vacation hotel booking sites. We chose our hotel, Hampton Inn, right? You don't think that's going to break the bank. It's about $80 a night, and I had it all budgeted out. The vacation to San Antonio was going to cost us about $1,200, but I was pretty stressed out about it because if I spent that money, I felt like I should have been investing it, right? I should have been saving it. I should have been working towards getting out of the corporate rat race. And so when my wife went to bed thinking that we're going to go on vacation and go stay at the Hampton Inn, I got back online and I canceled the Hampton Inn and I scheduled a hotel half the price, but the pictures look nice, right? And I'll never forget this. We get in the car getting ready to go from Dallas down to San Antonio, and I'm totally stressing my wife out. I didn't realize I was doing this, but I'm talking about when we drive down there, we're going to go to restaurants and we're just going to order from the same, you know, the same plate. You know, no upsizing the meal, no drinks, you know, we'll just share our food, we're going to be cheap. And, you know, so I'm stressing her out, and we finally get to San Antonio, and it couldn't have been worse or better at the same time. We're pulling into the hotel at about sundown, and she obviously realizes it's not the Hampton Inn, and we pull into the hotel, and we walk into the front counter to check in, and the guy takes our money, and he has this jacket on, and he flips it around, and the jacket, now that he's flipped it around, says security on the back end. And the hotel clerk, in his security jacket, walks us to our room, and I could see immediately why he had to have a security jacket on, because this hotel looked like something that you would pay for by the hour, not by the night. We get into the hotel room. It's dirty. It's nasty. There's cockroaches, dead ones on the floor, and my wife just starts crying. The vacation hadn't even started, and I've totally blown it and ruined it from the very beginning. And she says, let's just go home. This is not a vacation. Let's just go home. And she was right. And at that moment, I had two choices in my mind. I didn't know what to do. Should I just throw out all of the ideas of saving and investing and getting out of the corporate rat race and just spend my money today? Or should I tell my wife that, hey, we're not going to go on vacation. We're not going to do any of this stuff. And maybe one day when I have enough, this will work. And that was my dilemma that I found at the time.
I can echo those same feelings. I always had the guilt of this should be go into investment so I can get out of my job and whatnot. And it adds a lot of stress to the vacation. Like me and my wife didn't go on our honeymoon until we had our third kid.
Oh my gosh, that's crazy.
And she finally said, "Hey, dude, we're going on a honeymoon. I don't care what happens with your job. We're going." And it was the best decision I ever made.
Yeah, totally. Fast forward that in a little bit, and we're going to show you how to do this today. All right, so fast forward that a little bit. My wife and I, we're getting ready to take the kids in April of this year. We're going to fly them out to Disney World. My wife and I also this year are going to go to the Grand Cayman, just the two of us. So we're going to go on two really nice vacations this year, one with the family and one with just my wife and I. And we're doing all of this out of a better strategy, one that will allow me to take my money and make it do quite literally two jobs at the same time. Right, I'm going to have my money growing and compounding, but yet I get to use the value of that money today to accomplish really short-term goals, which is really what money's all about, right? I mean, if you pull out a $20 bill out of your wallet today, look at that piece of paper. It's just a piece of paper. It has no intrinsic value in and of itself. But what money does allow you to do is create life, create experiences, create value. And that's really what I was putting off back in those early vacation days. I was deferring my life, deferring vacations, hoping that one day I'd have enough to be able to start using money to create life, right?
Right.
All right. So let's dive into it. And here's what we're going to do. We're going to bring up some math in this, and we're going to go through this mathematically. And Jimmy, you've got a really amazing angle to take on this with real estate that we'll talk about. But I'm going to draw this out. I'm going to kind of set the stage for us just a little bit, okay? We're going to draw a line here, and we're going to say that this line represents $0, break even. And if we think about, let's just use this vacation. How much did that Airbnb, how much did that vacation cost you guys that you guys took just recently?
$325 a night.
$325 a night. Total cost of the vacation, give or take.
The whole vacation or just the Airbnb?
Yeah, the whole vacation.
I don't know, $5,000.
Okay, perfect. All right, so let's say that our goal
is... By the way, I was looking at real estate, so it was a business expense. So this is pre-tax dollars.
Nice. Okay, perfect. I like that. So there's a lot of different ways to do this, especially when you're a real estate guy, to make this deductible and make this part of your real estate portfolio.
We have any LLC. We could have built it to Susie's Photography because she took a lot of pictures there too.
I love it. That's one of the benefits of having a business for sure. So let's say the goal is to go on a $5,000 vacation every single year, right? Every year you want to take your family back out to Florida or to some location and create those experiences, right? Every single year. But here's how you do it. If you're a normal person, remember, $1 equals $1. So you can either take that money and spend it or you can take it and save it. There's no in between with this. And so what most people do is they either save for their vacations using cash or they use debt to pay for their vacations. But in both cases, it's a different side of the same problem. So if you're using cash, all you're really doing is you're kind of saving up money every single month, right? Kind of like a stair stepper, taking a little bit of money and putting it aside. And when it comes time to go on vacation, I'll just draw a boat here. Let's say you're going on a cruise. When it comes time to go on vacation, what do? We take that money out of the bank. We spend it. We go out and we have a great time. We come back with some good pictures and some good memories. But the money that we just spent is gone, right?
Right.
Now, if we want to do this again next year, what do we have to do, Jimmy?
Find the same stairs.
Yeah, you got it. We got to go through the same process over again, right? Save up another $5,000 and spend it and go through this process over and over and over again. And here's the interesting thing.
With after-tax dollars, you have to build that staircase up another third.
Yeah.
Because a third of that money is going to the government.
You got it. That's a really good point, man. Really good point. If you're not using cash, you're using debts. And debt is the other side, but it's the same problem, right? All we do with debt is we just spend the money today, and then we spend the next amount of time paying off the debts, but we still end up at the same spot. $0, break even, right? We've got to go through the whole process over again, okay?
Well, now you're adding interest to a credit card or your HELOC or wherever, plus taxes.
You got it.
Because you got to get taxed to then pay back the credit card.
Perfect. So the whole concept here is we want to have a better strategy. We want to have a better system. And we all know the eighth wonder of the world, right, is compound interest. Everyone talks about the value of compound interest, but yet I would venture to say that you and most people don't ever earn compound interest. Now, you might be one of the people that have found a way to make your money consistently grow, and man, that's awesome, but most people don't ever earn compound interest, and here's the whole problem with that. Compound interest is nothing more than a function of time, right? Your money is in some investment. It grows a little bit the first year, then the interest plus the principal grows a little bit again the second year, and this slowly builds up until we get to these big astronomical gains down here, right? But the reason most people don't ever earn compound interest is one of two things happen. And in this example, we're going to talk about one of the things that happens is they spend their money, right? They put it in a place, they're just starting to get compound interest off the ground, and now they're ready to take that great vacation. They spend their money, and if they never ever spend the money again, right, what happens? The compound interest curve resets, and there's always this void. There's always this opportunity cost of when we spend our money. Okay, that was my whole dilemma with my example is I didn't want to spend my money because I wanted it to grow and compound. And one day when I was maybe up here and I had enough money, then I could spend my money. Right. Have you ever felt like that, Jimmy?
Yeah. When you're reading all these entrepreneurial books and talking about compounding interest and, you know, building your passive income, no one tells you it's impossible to go through life without consuming. You know, you read the Dave Ramsey stuff and it's not a very inspiring way to live, and I don't think it's very realistic to not consume money. You're going to have to spend money sometime, somewhere.
Yeah. So the whole question is, do we have a better way to do this then? Is there a better way to spend this money? So let's go through this really quick. If we take this same strategy that we have up above, now we're not going to go into, in fact, let's do this really, really quick, Jimmy. I'm going to pull up one of your policies.
Did I lose you?
No, I'm still on. Can you hear me all right?
You broke up for about 30 seconds.
Okay. Yeah, I can still get you, and I got your audio coming through.
Okay. But does that make sense with the opportunity cost? It's unrealistic to think you can go through life without consuming.
Totally. 100%. I mean, that just goes back to the whole purpose of money, right? Money is really meant to be used. It's not meant to sit in some vault, you know, forever and ever and ever. It's meant to create value. Okay, so all we're going to do here then is we're going to just look, Jimmy, I hope you're okay with this. I know we didn't talk about this, but we're going to look at one of the policies that we were considering for you in the beginning. And we're going to say, hey, you were planning on saving about $30,000 a year into this policy. And we're going to talk about the value of compounding. So let's just go down and let's assume that you put in $30,000 a year every single year for the next 30 years. What that's going to provide you is it's going to provide you $2.4 million of cash, of compounding. Right, you've put in 900 and you have 2.4 to show for it. Now, if this money were anywhere else, that money would have to sit in this account locked up like a vault. You would never touch it, never use it, never think about it. And that's how you would get this, maybe. The unique thing about this strategy, though.
And that's a big maybe.
Big maybe, right? Big maybe. And that's in other investments like the stock market.
And you got to bring up the fact that that amount is not subject to market volatility.
Perfect. You got it. This is protected, private, safe money, not subject to market volatility, guaranteed by an insurance company that has done these type of contracts for hundreds, plural, hundreds of years.
And could survive the next crash.
You got it. But here's the biggest unique part about this. Your money now has the ability to do two jobs. It can accomplish your short-term goal of going on a vacation or buying a rental home or whatever it is. But it can also accomplish your long-term goal. Your money can literally do two jobs at the same time. So let's look at how this works. Anything you want to add to that, Jimmy?
Nope.
Okay. All right. So all this really is then is we're going to take the cash, the $5,000 that you were going to spend on a vacation, and we're going to have a better system with it. We're going to take that cash and put it into cash value inside of a life insurance policy. What that means is now your cash value is represented by this compound interest line, right? Cash value. It's going to compound and grow every single year. But in this concept, you now have a very unique opportunity that you can use your money today when it's most valuable to you for whatever you want to use it for. If you want to use it for a vacation, if you want to use it to buy a rental home or anything in between, you get unlimited access to how to use this money, but you want to use it strategically. So we dump this cash value into a policy where it's growing and compounding. We then take a policy loan that we're going to explain on the next slide here. So we take the money, a policy loan, but unlike up at the top, when we pay back the loan, right, just as if we're saving for our vacation again next year, there's a difference. We didn't break the compound interest curve, right? There, and in the beginning, this difference is small, but over time, it compounds quite large. We didn't break the compound interest curve. We got to use our money today, and next year, when we take another policy loan, again, to go on another vacation and pay it back, you'll notice that the difference starts to get a little bit more dramatic.
And that dividend can help pay for next year's vacation.
Bingo. Yes, that compounding can definitely help pay for next year's vacation. And here's the fun part, right? We're just going to keep drawing up these stairs. And sorry, my stairs are getting worse as we go up this little compound curve here. Maybe it's altitude sickness, right? We're getting so much money that we're getting a little bit of altitude sickness.
So eventually the dividends from the policy pay for your vacation.
You got it.
So go back to the illustration. And this is the first policy I ever signed up with. I bought like four since then. But go show what year you get a $5,000 dividend.
Well, this is just the dividend. This is not including the guaranteed rate of return. Your total growth in the policy of $5,000 happens in year four. So in year four, right, you've got $5,000 of growth in the policy.
So year four, it pays for my annual, my January vacation to Marco Island.
You got it. And your money still continues to compound. And so let's go through the numbers on this, and so people can see how this works. I think I need to pull up one additional piece of digital paper here. Let me pull this up here. All right, okay, here's how it works. I'm gonna bring up a template here because this kind of helps me organize my thoughts and how this works. When you take out a policy like what we've just shown you here, there's some very unique strategy behind how to set up these policies, but you have a very unique opportunity inside of this life insurance policy. Real estate investors know how this works, but if you have money inside of a policy, and let's say $25,000. Let's go something kind of grandiose and big here. Let's say you've got $25,000 of cash value inside of your life insurance policy. That cash value can be used at any time for any reason, and you're 100% in control of it. But when you use that cash value, that money actually comes from the insurance company. You have a guaranteed written into your contract provision that you can take a policy loan anytime for any reason. Now, Jimmy, when you've taken your policy loans, what has the insurance company asked you to do to get a policy loan?
Nothing.
Nothing.
Just tell them where to wire the money.
Does it affect your debt to income ratio?
No.
Do you have to tell the insurance company how you're paying back the loan and set up a repayment schedule?
Nope.
None of
it. And I still, on my balance sheet, I still have that asset.
You got it. Here's the cool part. The way the policy loan works is this is a life insurance policy at its core. We set it up completely backwards from how most people think of life insurance. But Jimmy, in your policy, you have a death benefit in this policy of $1.3 million. So what that means is the life insurance company, all they really do is they use that death benefit as collateral. If you took a policy loan of $25,000 today and you died the next day, they will pay out your death benefits to your beneficiary minus the outstanding policy loan. So they use it as collateral, but they put you in charge of it 100%, which means you get to determine how you pay it back, when you pay it back, if you pay it back, or anything like that. Now, here's, I know this is cheesy, but let me throw it out there. Have you ever seen, you saw them, you watched Spider-Man, right, Jimmy? You watched some of those Marvel stuff, right?
Yeah.
So in the first Spider-Man, when Peter Parker gets bit by the spider, he's in the cab with his uncle, right? And his uncle doesn't really know what's going on with Peter Parker, but he says something pretty telling that I like to think about when taking a policy loan. He says, "Peter, hey, with great power comes great responsibility." And that's kind of the way this works, right? You were in control 100%. You have all of the power of how this works, but you need to use it responsibly. So anytime you take a policy loan, what we tell people is you want to have an intention, a strategy to pay it back. That doesn't mean you have to stick to it. You know, things will come up, but you want to have a strategy to pay it back. What are your thoughts on that, Jimmy?
Yeah, I wouldn't take a policy loan to go to the casino.
Yeah, that's a good point.
I mean, I have a plan to my vacation policy loan, whatever that $5,000, I'll just divide it by 12 and pay it back monthly.
You got it. You got it. And just pay it back as if you're saving up for your vacation next year, right?
Right. It's my bank, so I'm fine with that.
Okay. So let's
make this. Doesn't kill my cash flow all year round.
You got it. You got it. Let's make this a big. Let's make this kind of a bigger thing. Let me just to make the numbers a little bit more compelling and understandable. Let's say you take a $25,000 policy loan and you decide to go on a vacation of a lifetime. My wife and I were considering actually going on a 6-week road trip all the way up and down the coast of California, up into Canada and back. And you know it's going to cost a pretty decent amount of money. But let's say it's going to cost $25,000, and we're going to take this loan with the intention of paying it back over 5 years. Okay. Uh-huh. The insurance company, they're actually going to loan us the money. They're just going to use the policy as collateral, but the money comes from the insurance company. So in a real estate investor, it's just like taking a home equity line of credit. You still get to keep the home, live in the home, do all the things that you're doing with the home, but that you get to take a line of credit on your house. It's the same thing with an insurance policy.
I don't have to give a personal guarantee either.
Yeah, you got it.
Huge.
So the insurance company is going to charge us in interest rates. Now, it depends on the insurance company that we're working with, but most of these interest rates today are around 5%. So, Jimmy, you take a loan, $25,000, 5%. We're going to pay this thing back over 5 years. The loan works just like any other simple interest loan. So let's pull up a calculator just to throw some numbers at this. All right, so we're going to do a calculator to show how this works. So let's say we're going to take a $25,000 loan at 5%, and we're going to pay it back. Let's say we're going to pay it back monthly, right, over 6 months, or excuse me, 5 years, so 60 months. Now, again, the insurance company doesn't ask for any of this, so we want to go in intentionally with this great responsibility we have, or with great power, we have great responsibility. So in this example, we would just set up that we would make a payment of $471.78. And if we did this every single month for 60 months, the loan would be paid back. Now, if we start making payments for our first couple months and then something comes up and we want to shut it down, we shut it down. And then when we start it up, you know, we can start it up and pay $300 or $400 or $1,000 or $200. We can make the payments however we want.
When you shut it down too, there's no credit card company calling collections or destroying your credit or calling in a personal guarantee coming after the property.
You got it. You got it. It's pretty powerful. Here's the math though. The first payment that you make.
Is that including interest?
Yeah, this will include interest. So right here, there's two columns that we're going to look at, right? So right here is our payment. So we'll notice that if we want to do this the way we're setting it up, we would make a payment of $471.78. That first payment that we make, $367 of that payment would go to principal. It would pay down the balance of the loan, and it would take our loan from $25,000 down to $26,000. But $104 of that payment would go to interest, right? It would be a cost to us. It would be going to the insurance company. But the next time we make a payment, the same payment, a little bit more of our payment goes to principal and a little bit less goes to interest, simply because the loan balance is smaller. We're being charged interest on a smaller loan balance. So every time we make a payment, this is the math behind how it works. Now, if we follow this out right down here at the bottom, for those of you watching this, right down here at the bottom, you could see our total interest would have been $3,307 in this example, okay? So we're gonna write that right here, $3,307. We're gonna say that this is our cost. Now the whole question is, and I remember when I first learned about this, I felt like, why would I pay the insurance company to use my money? Why don't I just take the $25,000 out of my bank account or out of my investments and go spend it? Why would I pay the insurance company to use my money? Because there's a cost associated with that, right?
Yep.
So here's the
benefit. This is the single biggest objection to these policies.
You got it. And once you see it, this it's so simple. Once we see it, here's the simplicity. Here's how it works. Our cash value, our $25,000, never really came out of our policy. Remember, the loan, it came directly from the insurance company. And the only way we can access this loan is by having a policy. But the benefit is, our $25,000 continues to compound. Now, this is where your mind will really be blown if without going through the numbers. We're earning a 5% interest rate. We're being charged a 5% interest rate. And on the surface, it looks like there's no value, right? If we're paying 5% and earning 5%, most people would just feel like that's a wash. But the difference is we're earning compound interest. Remember that curve that we showed earlier? We're earning compound interest. and this functions entirely different from simple interest.
So, tax-free compound interest.
Tax-free. That's huge, huge tax-free. So that that $25,000 earning 5% over 5 years, right? The first year we earn 5%, we earn $1,250. Yeah, that's okay, but right, we earn $1,250. Next year, our account balance now is $26,250, and we earn 5% on that. So it's a bigger balance, so we earn a little bit more interest that year. Now that interest is added to our principal. It's locked in. It becomes part of your contract. You'll never lose it. And so you earn 5% on that. And so you earn a little bit more interest. And you can see every year the compounding, it's just getting bigger and bigger every year. So if you took 10 years to pay off your policy loan, if you took 5 years to pay off your policy loan, if you took 12 months to pay off your policy loan, the math works in your favor, right? The cost of the loan goes down, the compounding goes up. And at the end of this five-year example here, you'll notice what we would have earned is $6,907, right down here at the bottom, $6,907. Okay, we're going to bring that calculator back here in just a minute, but let's put this right here, $6,907, and we're going to put this as our profit, okay? Now, compound interest just works the exact opposite. It's building on top of itself year over year. So it's getting bigger every single year, and here is how your money just did two things at the same time. Jimmy, you got back from your vacation in Florida and you had a fantastic time, didn't you?
Yep.
And what did you want? What do you want to do again next year?
I'm going to do the same thing. I'm going to get out of St. Louis when it's cold.
You got it. You got it. And man, every year I'm telling you, this has literally changed my life, saved my marriage, and helped me get closer to my kids. Every year we sit down and we have a fantastic time planning out what our next vacation is going to be. Last year we went, where did we go last year? Last year we took our kids on this fabulous tour through Zion's, the Grand Canyon, all those places. And my wife and I, we went to South Carolina. Had a great time. This year we're going to Grand Cayman. And you know, every year we sit down and we just enjoy this process of planning. And then when we're out on the vacation, man, we have such a good time. Before, when I was stressing my wife out about not spending money at restaurants, we go out to the nice restaurants, we do the excursions, we do the activities, we do all the fun stuff, and we have such a fun time on these vacations. And the reason for it, this doesn't give me permission to spend beyond my means. If I can't afford to make the payment back, I shouldn't do it. But it does give me the permission to use my money today to create value in my relationships, to create value in my life, knowing that I get to use the money for that purpose, but my money still continues to compound. It was doing two jobs.
And you get dividend money that you don't even have anymore.
You got
it. You've already spent. Nice.
And here's the profit, right? We earned $6,907. We paid $3,307. We came up ahead, what is this, $3,600. So over this five-year period of time, we got to go on a $25,000 vacation. We had a fantastic time doing it. We came ahead $3,600 in profit. And the big value of this is, let's say, I mean, let's just go back to that compounding calculator here for just a minute. Let's say you do this. Let's say you do this for the next, man, what do you say? I mean, let's just say you do this for the next 50 years, right? You just use your policy over and over and over and over again. And when you become older and you have grandkids, you take your grandkids out. $25,000 compounding over 50 years grows to $286,000. Now, if you had that money anywhere else, that $25,000 would literally have to sit in that account and it couldn't do anything. Right, you'd have to sit in that account. You couldn't use it, you couldn't touch it. But sometime at 50 years, then you could say, okay, now I've got 286, what to do with it? But with this, you can get to use it every single year and still get to the same spot. So Jimmy, what are your thoughts
sold.
There?
I'm sold, that's why I bought so many of these policies.
Tell them about the real estate.
If you look at the delta between 6,900 and 3,307, that's what? That's like a 14% return over 5 years. So, I mean, it's not astounding, but that's like 3% a year. So, if you were a mutual fund manager, you'd be like, I'm a hero.
And you're right. I mean, that's just looking at it from the numerical side, but looking at it from the opportunity that you still get to use your money and get that percentage of great growth.
You're not paying with your vacation from your 401k or your IRA.
Yeah.
I mean, I think that's a pretty good point, that money you sock away in your IRA, you still can't touch till you're 65.
Yeah. Just sitting there.
So you're passing up all those vacations, everything.
So a lot of times what we talk about, Jimmy, with people is we talk about how to use this concept strategically to grow wealth, right? If you go to our website, cashflowtactics.com, you can see, you know, we talk a lot about using this for real estate. And honestly, this is primarily where you and I use this concept, is to invest in real estate and other assets. But I'm telling you, this emotional side, this family side of using a policy, this has literally saved my marriage and changed my life. It really has. I mean, it got me out of that being the Scrooge McDuck type of guy that I was early on in my life, to where I would cancel the Hampton Inn and stay in a cheap cockroach infested hotel. And I thought that would do it. And it really, I ruined the whole purpose of why we were going on vacation. I mean, we weren't connecting. We were fighting over money because I didn't understand this simple concept.
Yeah. And I mean, how many marriages have fights because of money? So if this is just one thing, alleviating one fight a year, what is that worth?
Yeah. Yeah. All right.
I'm sold. I hope everybody else watching this is sold. Come to Cash Flow Tactics, buy policies, go on vacations. Have a good weekend, Ryan.
All right, Jimmy. You take it easy, man.
All right. See you, bye.